this year, the Seminars in the City was taken up by the International Resource Network. So throughout the year, we've had a number of events based on different regions of the world. And so coming up, we've got events on Asia and Africa. So I really encourage you guys to take a look at our website, take a look at our upcoming newsletter, to check those out. And also just want to let you guys know that we are a nonprofit organization that's based in CUNY, but we don't get any funding from CUNY. And so the chance to deliver really great programming is really rooted in our membership. And so if you're enjoyed today's experience or past CLAG's experiences, I really encourage you to check out our hot little red brochure in the back. And yeah, I'll just let Jasmina and YY take it away whenever they're ready.
So we're going to have a little delay, I think. We're going to bear with a little feedback coming from me, especially because I'm going to try not to talk much. So I think that Svetlana tell us more about her experiences with the situations in the Balkans and specifically from Bosnia. Svetlana is involved with Queer, which is an organization in Bosnia that deals with LGBT human rights in Bosnia and is working with other organizations in the region that deal with bettering human rights in the area. Svetlana, did you want to say more about who you are and what's your position within the region?
You have been involved in CC Network, which is a network, a web network in the Balkans and more in the region. I'm not sure what else to tell you, so I.
Which are regions that were created after the end of the war in Bosnia. And while there's something that is resembles the federal government, there, a lot of institutions are existing fairly independently. the regions. So the organization that's being formed is now one of the first in the other part of Bosnia and Herzegovina. Right, the other entity. So, in your experience, did much change since 2002, since queer started operating in Bosnia?
Things have started changing. There are a lot of things that changed, and there are a lot of things that didn't change, and then there are a lot of things that went back. So, it's been over 7 years now, and it's very interesting to take a look at all of it. Legislatively, things seem to be doing okay. So, Bosnia and Herzegovina is the last one in the region to have a registered organization, meaning that even Kosovo has a registered organization working on LGBT issues and even better than an independent state. So we're the last ones, but we do have legislation that on the paper doesn't seem to be that bad at all. There is a law on equality of gender or equality of sexes. Since a few months ago, there's an anti-discrimination law in the codexes, which there are four, actually only include sexual orientation within the anti-discrimination law. However, none of that is being implemented. There's no visibility, the state doesn't propagate human rights, which includes all vulnerable groups, etc. So about 3 years ago, I think the momentum is still going up, right? And under that, I mean, when you did your work and reconnecting with people, organized things, there was specific receptivity which gave hope for moving forward. I would say that about 3 years ago up to now, there was a specific decline, not only regarding our activism and actions, but just in general, social change. Corruption has become more visible. People have become more unsatisfied. The recession that is going on, people not being paid, retirees just having very difficult situations, but overall frustration has been building up, and I would say that things now all around are much worse than they were in 2002, and then there's a specific momentum of decline because we are also human beings and we can withstand all kinds of hostility, but sooner or later it becomes too much. So it is good that there are other organizations, it is good that there are more organizations inclusive queership because it allows us to make specific strategy, but I am afraid that at this point there's not much we can do in order to produce visible social change, except for our own selves, for the population, on small bodies, perhaps empowering people so that they can actually make specific decisions for themselves regardless of their own practices as well. We have witnessed all the time. Defining in terms of the Trump state has taken care of that issue and has basically canceled it less than 24 hours before it was supposed to happen. We have seen that an initiative was stored in the, on the street, the bottom of the street, so if the trial actually took place, people would be ready to kill and to burn and to make damage. So we have witnessed more violence happening with more disability occurring all over the region.
And just to briefly summarize for those who may not be familiar with what happened in Belgrade, there was a Belgrade Pride in 2001, the first one that where a small group of activists came out on the streets and attempted to have a Pride march through the center of Belgrade. Through the center of Belgrade, and there were thousands of nationalists, hooligans, sport hooligans, soccer hooligans, and as well as religious fanatics who came out and have attacked this small group of activists. There were people who were seriously injured in the process. So there was really no serious attempts to have another Pride till this summer in Belgrade, when there was a Pride scheduled for September, I believe, and the Pride was canceled less than 24 hours before the actual event. because the government and the police said that they cannot provide any kind of safety or security to the participants, and they suggested to hold this event at a remote location outside of the city, or outside of the center of the city, because they said they cannot offer protection in the center of Belgrade, which was a huge slam in the face, not just people, not just the LGBT population, but any kind of human rights activists, because the government is saying that they're weaker than these nationalist forces, that they cannot protect their own citizens. So it was the government acknowledging this lack of power to defend their own people. So that's what happened in Belgrade this fall. So the second Belgrade Pride has not happened. So that's a brief summary of Pride events. Would you like to address a little about the events surrounding Queer Sarajevo, the festival from last fall, where the festival was interrupted?
I'm not even sure what it is today, because there's so much information, there's so much that happened to us. But Queer Sarajevo Festival was envisioned through our strategic planning in 2006, and we started working on it again in 2007 with another organization called Sarajevo Center. So we have two organizations to start this initiative. We parted ways March 2008, and has separated what we were doing, because there were three different things we were working on, and proceeded with Queer Sarajevo Festival as an idea. It was supposed to be something that we wanted to organize so that everything that we talk about in the media, workshops that we do, education sessions that we do, and you know, get blue in our face, make specific things, this was the best way to portray everything that we wanted to say and all the messages that we had kind of as LGBTQ individuals through film, through performances, through music, through exhibits. And it was what we thought to be the safest way, the least violent way, the most silent way, because it allows people to meditate, to evolve, you know, to have conversations with themselves. So we imagined this to be a safe space for the population, sometimes the best way to carry the message. However, we live in Sarajevo, and there was one thing that we didn't foresee, and we completely forgot about it, and that was that the month of September was the holding of the Ramadan, which lasts 30 days. It's a fasting holiday event, which rotates each year, and it moves over 11 days each year. So that year, it was pretty much happening for the whole month of September. We learned about it, and we decided that we will change our PR strategy. We're going to change our PR campaign. We're not going to be in the media. We're not going to do all these commercials of the thing. We're just going to downplay it and make it more famous in America. Ramadan, and we thought that it's not going to collide. However, it collided in a big way because it was used as an excuse. So Ramadan was really not an issue. The politicians have used it as an excuse. And at least somebody's right to religion, to not violence, to betray free speech, which led to the crimes that were being committed on a daily basis. And that's kind of what ended up happening. It was really a book example of what happens when you use hate speech. We decided not to cancel the festival, we received threats a month in advance. We were in the media, we had all kinds of credit. because we are dealing with an extremist religious fundamental group. So that store was attacked as it was being opened. There were about 12 individuals who basically hurt a lot of them. We ended up spending a lot of hours in the ER and not really getting much sleep at all. We decided to carry on the next day and to change our program, so to discuss violence that happened and how people were doing and how, you know, what was going on. We decided to cancel the 26th of September, which was the holiest night of Ramadan, in order to reschedule to Saturday and Sunday. The holiest night of Ramadan, which was supposed to be the most peaceful night, was the most horrible night of ours. That's when we had our car fall. We just had a lot of nonsense happen on that day. And we made a decision as a team, two against two. It was not a consensus, really. We decided that we can't go on. We did everything to protect everybody else. We were not doing anything to protect ourselves. Our office was having extremely weak doors. And it was a horrible feeling because you don't feel you're doing anything wrong. You feel that you're fighting for the right thing, and very quickly you end up finding that your place of birth and your place of life has shrunk to an extremely small place. There's no place you can go, there's no place you can hide. They can find you everywhere. Four of us, all four of us, were pretty much in the media. We were targeted throughout the whole month. We had our addresses listed online publicly. We had a contact. So you just feel like a war zone. You literally, like, I don't know how many of you saw 2012. I've seen it a couple days ago. And it reminded me of the feeling of there is no safe place. Like, there is no place at that moment where you can go and feel safe. That's how it felt, for me at least, during the Bisexual festival, because I had not slept 50 hours, and at the moment when I came back to the office, that's where we were sleeping. And Alina and Bobo were in a different police station because we had to report for the crime on the locality where it happened. I was in the same clothes for 2 days, and I couldn't have my eyes open anymore. And I remember telling Alma that I had to stay awake because I just was imagining people bursting in our office and killing us, because at that moment you don't feel there's any place where you can go and relax alone for at least 5 minutes and not feeling that something's going to happen. And you feel responsible for all participants, all guests, the whole population, one that's out and one that's not out. It was a huge event, huge passing of responsibility. Basically, we ended up having to be responsible for anything that happens in the street, because the police was not doing their job, because the state was not doing their job. And that's really not how things should be. We ended up going to psychotherapy as a team and as an organization afterwards. We ended up having a lot of issues come up as a result of that. We ended up having officials from the population mostly being scared. Our website has been hacked. There have been video streams on YouTube, which were also threatening. So it took us some time for us to move out into our office. We had to get phone back online. We were in contact with people. Very small number felt energized and they wanted to do something about it, but most people felt we were in contact with people. Very small number felt energized and they wanted to do something about it, but most people felt scared. And it was taking a few steps back. The price for us to feel scared, or that we now have less space to move in, was increasing visibility of this issue in the state, and that was in some way very successful because it was the biggest, and we were told we couldn't have had a better commercial, but we paid price. We actually paid the price for raising those issues to such a level so that a lot of, everybody was talking about it, everybody was aware of it, but we paid the price in the country.
Yes, thank you. Which actually, all this brings me to my next question, which is, how does one reconcile this queerness and the queer identity with nationalism and national identity within the Balkans? it's there, because there seems to be a lot of conflict. If you look at all of the countries in the region, there's often a conflict between people who are nationalists and people who are embracing queer identity, and it becomes a question, can one even embrace their own national identity and embrace their queer identity at the same time?
I don't think you can. I mean, I think you can, but I don't think it's healthy. I think that people who protested against us have been doing an extremely good job of doing that in terms of making some of their identities, because same people who protested from the academy and against the festival were the same people protesting and being present in the demonstration for the Gaza issue, which is also a place where we would be present, different cause and for totally different reasons. Same cause but different reason for different interpretation. I think you can reconcile a lot of things, but it's not going to be healthy. We are very aware that if we were not living in a nationalistic and fascist society, these issues would not be a problem, or they would be less of a problem. We're aware that we can't fight for only one issue and stick to that issue and not care about the others. So we can't really dissect human rights and be like, oh, I'm going to fight for this issue and I'm going to, you know, be very derogatory regarding everything else. It doesn't work that way, because it's either all or nothing. We're either all going to be free, we're all going to be safe, we're all going to be respecting each other and ourselves, or it's just not going to be happening. It's not a matter of choice. It's not a supermarket where you buy what you want and you get out. So activists are aware more and more now that it's a joint fight, that we need a different strategy. When I say activists, I don't mean LGBTIQ. I think that women and women activists, women's rights are getting ignored, because this issue has raised for us in Bosnia, given that religion is getting more power in public space. It has basically been an eye-opener to how kind of society we live in, and that it's just a matter of time when how it's us and how it's somebody else.
So, thank you. I would like to join Boris, who has just entered the chat room. Boris is... from Serbia and is working with Gay Straight Alliance, one of the LGBT human rights groups in the Balkans. I would just like to check and make sure that he can hear us. Okay, so while we're trying to see if we can get Boris to, if we can hear him. Let's get back to Svetlana. So it's sort of the same question again. We're sort of looking at this idea of nationalism and how nationalism is creating a space that's hostile to the not just LGBT population, but really any non-nationalist population in the region. And you said the same people that you see who are protesting any kind of improvement in LGBT rights or any kind of queer event, these are the same people that can be seen in some other instances of protests.
Which doesn't, can do much unless it's supported. So if the government supports it or it's quiet, meaning it supports it through its silence, it allows for all kinds of bullshit. So it's not only LGBTIQ, it's about women, it's partner, connected to children, to abortion, to anything that doesn't fit the agenda. And the agenda is one that is male. So it is, you're talking about patriarchy, which is extremely connected and strong with the nationalism. So you have that prism, and then you have the prism find one that it's, I studied national design, I have one interest in it, so I kind of feel like I can talk a lot about it. But it's a suicidal mission. It can run its course, but sooner or later, it's basically going to self-destruct. For us, it has been running for extremely long time. It is extremely destructive to its own self, not only to anything that is different. But the main and key point is that as long as it's being supported by the government, as long as the government is scared, and that pretty much was the case with what we've seen in Serbia, because in Serbia, the government told it and basically said, there's nothing we can do against the violence and these threats. It's a power game. Nationalism is literally about power game, where on one side you have the national identity and building this fairy tale of superiority, and then on the other side it's everything and everybody else. There's no price that high that you will not pay for such fairy tale concept, because it is connected to everything that you know since you've been born. I'm speaking about the things that you have in your head, not necessarily natural or realistic situation. It's extremely destructive, and we have witnessed its destruction on a daily basis. Given that people who live in our region have pretty much gotten used to, I would say, have gotten used to specific discourse, we no longer notice issues that are key, such as extremely destructive, hostile, and violent communication, which is the first thing. You can't communicate, you can't communicate effectively. And I'm talking about daily communication. It's about nonverbal communication. Anybody who feels in a democratic society that they can come up to you and tell you all kinds of nonsense about you and about them killing you and about you being, you know, number one on their list of enemies. It's a society where it has long been past the point of positive communication. We have lost our brains long time ago. Not even professional structure communication, we have gotten hostility. And it's like a pot of boiling water where you put a frog, and you keep boiling the water little by little so the frog doesn't notice, or the frog notices it's cooked. But if you put a frog into a boiling water, it's going to jump out. If you put it in cold water that flows progressively, it's not going to notice. That is the Balkans. These changes, negative ones, happen so slightly, and they all become part of that magic circle that even we who live there can't notice it. And we have been in that boiling water for extremely long time. This nationalism and the rhetoric of it is being supported, and nothing is done to stop it. So it can only exist as long as it's being supported, and it's being supported because being supported, and it's being supported because.
Thank you. Okay, so we're gonna try something different. We're going to try. He's gonna type it, and I'm gonna actually read it. So it might help. So one of the main problems in Serbia is that the old national identity has been defeated. But the new national identity has not been created. And so we have people who are representatives of this old nationalist politics who are not unlike wounded animals, even more dangerous. Because what's happening is that they have been they have lost their positions, and they understand they have lost the war, and they can't anymore lead the politics from the 90s when there was a war in the Balkans, and so they can't they lost it, they lost the power, but they are, but those who need to lead the new politics and who should be more positive toward the queer identities don't have the courage to stand up for the queer people. So we have these new politicians that are not part of the old nationalist politics of the 90s that led the war, but they don't have the balls really to say we need to give the same rights to the queers because they don't want to lose the elections. So now we have this wounded animal that's performing a lot of very serious violence toward new enemies. These new enemies are Roma people or LGBTQ people, as well as the smaller religious groups, people who belong to minority religions. And this is partially because they lost the war against the Croats, they lost the war against the Bosnian Muslim or Bosniaks, and they lost the war against Albanians from Kosovo. And so they're now finding these targets within their own country that are these minority groups that are either LGBT or Roma people or the religious minorities. And so those whose job is to protect the LGBT people are either being very shy about it and very timid about this protection, or they're not doing anything at all. So queer people are perhaps the main victims of the after-war period of transition, because what happened with the forbidding Pride in Belgrade this year, canceling the Pride in Belgrade this year, is a result of this situation. Now there is a problem within the LGBT community itself. They are getting stronger, they're getting organized, but they're still not in a position to make some kind of serious struggle. There are very few people who are active in any kind of human rights organizations, including cultural or artistic organizations. So there are very few people who are generally active, or any kind of group. It doesn't even have to be LGBT group. There are just very few people who are generally activists who are trying to change the situation. So queer people or generally activists are stuck between modernization that's always bringing struggle and is always carrying victims with itself. And all those people who were nationalists, who were working against the not just LGBT population, but really any civil rights oriented group in the past 15 years. But Boris says he would like to be an optimist, and it is hard to be an optimist today. But you have people around yourself who are suffering, who are suffering consequences. So that was his answer to the question that I had. Thank you, Boris. Svetlana, did you want to add something to this?
I completely agree with his metaphor of the wounded animal. It's a perfect way to simplify the range of participation at all. I too feel that, I have been an optimist for years, and I just feel that this is not the time to fight some battles, because I feel that we're just going to be missed, because everybody's going to be missed. These wounded animals are like roaring, and now we are witnessing, at least in Bosnia and Herzegovina, where they're starting to fight each other. But they actually started having friction from one segment of Islamic political religious cohort, and they started fighting among each other. We ended up having gay dancers shot on the spot. We ended up having mayors who were killed because they, you know, basically decided not to offer drinks to underage drinkers on the spot with a gun, and they ran off to Croatia. I mean, there's just a lot of stuff happening, which is extremely unusual because when you have so many frustrated people, and nobody's really coming out about this process, and I'm trying to make this parallel between coming out in terms of LGBTQ and coming out in terms of all of these other issues. The truth really has to come out, and people need to speak openly about issues at hand, and I think that if that would happen, a lot of frustration would be released, because it's not really about these guilty, it's about wanting, about us wanting to move forward. We do lack a specific strategy, and so many times I wish that we would have a psychic at hand, a person who would say, you know, it's within 5 years, within 10 years. It's extremely difficult time, because you end up putting a lot and you end up getting so little back. So sometimes I also wonder if this is the time when we need to just stay away or concentrating on supporting individual identities, which we have been doing all along, because this wounded animal is picking up. It's not slowing down, it's actually picking up.
Thank you. So another question that I had for both of you is this question of rights, and I guess public, of the whole issue of coming out in the Balkans, of being out in public, of not having enough people who are out. How important do you think it is to have public events? How, because there are a lot of people in the LGBT population who are very strongly opposed, who feel that these things are more harmful than helpful. So, yes, and I guess whichever one of you wants to start it. Okay, Boris, you're on.
We can alternate.
And just for those of you who are watching online, we're going to have a question and answer session at the end, so you'll have a chance to talk. Boris says, we have two problems when it comes to coming out. First one is that there is a real danger to coming out in the region. There's a lot of violence that is that exists in the region. He would like to compare the situation in Serbia and the region with the situation in the United States 30 years ago. So we have this one situation, so we have this real fear of people are afraid of actual violence, but we also have the issue of conformism in people. And so people today have things that they have not had 30 years ago. People have cell phones and internet and technology that they did not have 30 years ago. And these things are making communication, one-on-one communication, easier. And it's much easier to actually find a partner today than it was 30 years ago because of these technical advances. You don't have to go to a Stonewall Inn. So it's much harder to recruit people in a classical way because a lot of people are meeting online. A lot of people are finding sexual partners online and then meeting up and not necessarily needing to go to community spaces. It's harder to convince them to come out. And that's making the movement much weaker. And so it remains on those who are the ones that are braver ones, the ones with more courage, to give their example, to motivate people. And he wants to honor Svetlana for her courage that she's showing. Because he doesn't feel that he's had the kinds of problems that she's been dealing with. And he doesn't really know that a lot of activists in Serbia in the past 10 years have had the same kinds of problems that she's facing in Bosnia. There are threats. There are people meeting you in the street and threatening you. But nothing as serious as she had and as activists in Bosnia had to face. And so he wanted to say that she was, or she is, an example to himself. And for now, that's how things are functioning in the area. But LGBT activists are pioneers in the region. The LGBT movement. Even if it sounds egocentric, but it is showing to some kids that are coming up, that are growing up, to some kids in high schools, college students, that you can be out. That you can be politically engaged, involved, and survive in the region. And if you look at the past 10 years in Serbia, the situation is getting better. It is slow, and it's not as far or as fast as we would want, but step by step there are some improvements. Svetlana, do you want to jump in?
Making arrangements, agreements, speaking to committees, speaking to least five, I would say at least 10 people who would organize it. We have never come up to that number in Bosnia and Herzegovina in order to be able to organize Pride. Then you have other issues, security, location, like some of the things that we have taken care of and we have already discussed with the security agencies in advance. And then you have the issue of nobody showing up. But that's something that, you know, it can be symbolic, etc. I do think that for me, like when I look back at little steps and little moments that have empowered me and that have been extremely important to me, prides are one of them. I have actually felt extremely empowered and extremely strong by being in an arena where I, metaphorically, if nothing else, I felt secure and I felt safe and I felt like I was a member of a family. I felt I met my other part of the family, although I didn't know anybody. So I can abandon it. Anderson's Imagine Community Theory at work. So I do think it's extremely important. We belong to a culture that doesn't do rights. We don't do many protests. Protests, regardless of what issue they underline, are not. They're not supported. There's always somebody who is bitching about a protest that's happening because they can't cross the street or there's no public transport. People do not revel in people's attempt to fight for human rights, which also includes their human rights. So that brings the issue of how do we bring this issue up in a visible way and that it makes sense in the culture that we come from. Protests are the most seen with football fans, like the most things that we have on the street are football fans, and unfortunately they are our number one enemy. They're one of the guys that walks down on the streets is like partisans, and they can be in any environment and throw a rocket. So I think it's a challenge. How do you reconcile these things? What Boris said is that we like people. We like people for prize. We like people who sell the celebrity. We like people who are, and we been together exactly when we were performing on one of the third prize going backwards. And we were attacked actually going back to our apartment and during the pride and performances we had a fence on us, which is something I didn't mind. But it does bring specific feeling that, you know, things that you have to do to secure people, not just you but everybody else. It's a totally different ballgame. So we have to perhaps divide different strategies on how do we achieve the same goal by giving people what they want and giving people what they need and us all, you know, being safe and not taking the population few steps back. I actually wondered, because we're all racially connected, I wondered what if something happens during our break time. How would that be reflected on the first night of the festival? Because our event in 2009 was starting 4 days after Belgrade Pride. I have heard people say that it's devastating and how that's horrible, but I think that each thing that we do, regardless if we are able to feel more secure or not, is taking us one step forward. One thing that Boris said about honoring me, I actually have to honor everybody who's out, or everybody who's not even out, but who, provide specific connection or solidarity, because that's the only thing we came from. Like when you live a life like this, you realize that you have to replenish your energy, and there are not that many people, unfortunately, for us even less, with whom you can discuss and talk and feel alive and feel strong enough to carry on the next day. So it's the same thing for me. There are not that many of us. And it is important that there are people. I mean, you know, it's not easy. And I think unless we take care of each other, and for me particularly at this time, we're just going to be coming down as lies. You cannot do activism in volunteers with half cup full. You have to have a full cup. And you have to have a knowledge that it's only going to last as long as it's going to last, because it does have a date of expiration. And given that there are not that many of us, we actually have to take that into consideration as a part of strategy. Pride is something that always supports my identity. I feel completely alive. I feel very proud every time I'm inside. I've worked this year in a place I felt it was so important that I need to be there at least in solidarity. People have to see us. We are giving support to anybody who's not out, anybody who wants to walk on the street. Anytime you see two individuals of same sex or trans or queer in any way holding hands, it is humongous support because you're passing on the message. But there are all these other risks that Boris has already discussed, so you really have to figure out how to reconcile those two things and still carry on and not really get killed in the process.
So my last question that I had is, what is the role of the international community, particularly the European Union, but also just the general international community, in affecting the status of sexual minorities in the region? And we see this happen. We see countries, we see this with example of Uganda now. It's sort of like there are countries publicly expressing disagreement with the law that's being passed, and then you see within the country people saying, well, it's our country, we have the right to pass the laws we want to pass, where you have to tell us. So how much can international community actually help or not? How much those of us who are not in the region can actually do anything to assist people who are in the region and who are bravely struggling to just survive off from day to day. And I don't know if we want to again go to Boris and then Svetlana to kind of to mix you up. So first, it's important how much the actual country is interested in being part of integration, being part of connecting, the process of connecting. If the desire is bigger, then there is more effect in international pressure. So if the country wants to join the European Union, if the country wants to be part of certain global organizations, then the country will be more likely to listen to the pressure of the outside. So for example, if Serbia wants to become a member of the EU, then it is easier for the activists to use this desire to become a member of the EU and everything that EU brings with itself to the LGBTIQ movement. On the other hand, international community needs to become aware of the problem. So the community has to be aware that there is a problem. Problem is that international community is extremely slow, and it's very slow at comprehending the situation that are not part of their exact focus. So things that are not particularly important to the international community are not necessarily recognized immediately or as fast as it needs to be. So we had a situation that the state canceled the Pride in Belgrade, and then EU representatives or representatives of EU countries in Belgrade and international organizations and groups understand how much homophobia there is in the country. So even though there was homophobia for decades and this was brought to the attention of the EU countries, it took them a major event for this to be recognized. And also to understand how much Serbia can lead anti-European politics in
in certain times if you allow the country to run with this particular politics. There is the only groups that support unconditionally the LGBTIQ organizations in Serbia are international LGBTIQ organizations. Everything else becomes a part of global politics. So depending on the global politics, countries will offer or not offer support. So we know that, for example, Holland will use LGBTIQ issues, not only because they recognize these issues as important, but also because I don't want, because they don't necessarily want a country like Bulgaria or like Romania to enter the EU. So they will say, well, we're not letting you in because you don't support LGBTIQ issues, but the issue is not really just based on that. It's the issue that they don't want another of the Balkans countries entering the EU. So realistically, Europe does not need additional countries joining the EU. Europe does not need countries that are not necessarily following the same human rights guidelines that are prescribed by the European Union. They don't necessarily feel they need to add them. On the other hand, we have UK, Italy, or United States that are going to address some other issues, not necessarily the human rights issues, as more important when they're deciding if the countries should join the European Union in certain situations. So they may be more concerned about regional stability and security issues, and they might ignore the human rights violations or LGBT concerns in Serbia or countries or other countries in the region. It's all about being part of this interaction. Drawing international attention. On the other hand, internally from this area, from the local area, we need to find a way to raise our voices and act more efficiently and with more power, not necessarily depending on the outside assistance, and to talk about problems and to offer solutions to these problems. I like to say that USA is a problem-oriented nation. Excuse me. Problem-solving-oriented. We have to first bring our problems. We have to examine the problems and then find solutions. There are not many of us, as Svetlana said, but you always start with only a few people.
Svetlana, did you want to add to this sort of, again, just to remind you, the question is how much can international groups, how much can European Union or anybody from the outside really help with the situation?
I think that unlike the United States, we have basically used the platform of human rights, and that's something that we use in our daily work. So the EU Council here of the UN has the platforms that we've been using, and it's something that has been extremely beneficial because as opposed to saying that people have a right to live, we actually have a convention, we have a human right to call on because our states have they have an obligation to respect them because they're signatories of all of these conventions. So that's something that, at least the way that I personally feel it, has given us a solid ground to hold on to during our activism, because we don't have to have these theories of why it is important and, you know, all of these things. We actually have these conventions, and even if nobody understands them, we know that our officials in the governmental body do. Like, we kind of have to know what your audience is. So that's something that from the beginning has helped us, because it has given us tools and instruments to use and to filter where we actually fit and which ones are more important for us or not, to follow the example. One thing that is really the point of meeting is, unless we have similar interests, the same interests with international communities or international organizations at that time, we're not going to be extremely beneficial to each other. So it's like anything else. International organizations that have time, have resources, have shifted their tasks to our region will be there for us. Even if it's just symbolic, they'll be there for us. And as I said, little support can go a long way, because at least it takes one activist or one person doing their job in front of the computer. In wee hours, at least it makes it a little bit more worthy that, you know, it's valid and it's important, it has to be done. But unless we have same interests, it's not going to really go a long way. So I can give an example of lobbying for the anti-discrimination law in Bosnia and Herzegovina, which has been a painful thing to do, because you can actually see that our community and the international community, it's like it's two different worlds. We are somewhere in between. We understand our culture. We understand the way that it ticks. We also want to use we can operate professionally with this other part of the planet. And we're somewhere between how do you convey to politicians who do not want to change their opinion? How do you convey to individuals who just play foolish? I mean, that's really the regional mentality. When people do not want to understand you, they play deaf, dumb, they just play a game of I don't know what you're talking about. And they can be as much and full of prejudice as they can. It's very low herd mentality. I have actually listened to these parliamentarian sessions, and I am ashamed that I come from Bosnia and Herzegovina when I think of how we communicate in parliament. So EU, the UN and Council of Europe can benefit us and have to benefit us, given support, and sometimes that support can go a long way, sometimes it really doesn't do much for us, because there are different games that are being played by politicians. What I think is a challenge for us is activists and something that has to happen, especially in the states where we have more people being active on the ground, is that we have to dislocate. We actually have people that are lobbying, we have to have people who are versed with international organizations, be that yoga, EU, whoever. We have to have more people who can diplomatically work with the international community, with our politicians, with diplomats, with the population, with all segments that are needed. And I'm not sure we're quite there yet, but we have few years ago started entering the arena where there is a need. We do have an open door for communication and collaboration with not only international organizations but EU directly. And there are not that many people who can actually fully use the advantage of that. On the other hand, Bosnia and Herzegovina is not going to have a Schengen visa free, you know, entrance door as to the Australia Montenegro will on January 1st, which is going to just be more frustration for Bosnia and Herzegovina in general. So we will at some point stop following each other's example. At least, you know, I don't know how short or long it's going to be. But it will cause different issues. I think that EU and OHR, the Office of the High Commissioner, are having less and less speed in Bosnia and Herzegovina. It's very unfortunate, but especially the Office of OHR. We have looked up to them for support, and we looked up to them to give cultures. When they want to do it, it's abided by, when it's not a hot issue, it totally doesn't matter. I think that we really have to care about issues ourselves, and we have to do it. We can count on some support, but nobody's really going to do it for us. We have to do it on our own, and this is not only LGBTI, you know, pretty much, I'm talking about every, you know, everything and a lot of issues. This is something that one of our OHL representatives said, you know, if we want this badly enough, we're going to find a way. People will help us along the way, but, you know, I have helped and have worked with refugees when I lived in the United States. It, the worst thing you can do is to help somebody who is not capable or doesn't want to help themselves. That's pretty much the position of Bosnia and Herzegovina. Until we start having a goal of wanting to get out of this shithole that we're in and have been in since the war started, we are not making a representative example of anybody helping us. You know what? People say that when you fundraise for an organization, the best example you can give is by giving money to an organization because it shows that you believe in the issues that is portrayed. So it's similar for BIH. If we have to get out of this hole, I'm not sure how. We have received so much money, we have received so much support, it's totally gone in different ways. We have not hit the bottom yet, but it's not going to be worth to us unless it's done in any other way. And I think the international community, honestly, is getting a bit tired.
So I would like to actually, I would like to open the floor for the questions, both from the audience here and people who are online with us. We do have still half an hour left, so both if you two want to add something else, and also if we have questions. Both if you two want to add something else, and also if we have questions, it would be nice to hear from. So we have a question here in the studio, in the space. Do you? So we're gonna, I guess, have you talk in the microphone and see if you can hear. If you can't hear, let me know so I can repeat the question.
So good evening, Jasmina, Boris, and Svetlana, and everybody else listening to us. First of all, it's a great privilege to be here tonight and hear about your struggle. As a gay activist from Brazil, I think we have some differences and many similarities. I'll ask three questions. I'll be really quick, I promise. The first one more abstract and the two other more concrete. I've read the Arcadia Bulletin, dated in 1994, if I'm not wrong. And in this bulletin, I would say that the feminist technology of organizing named conscious groups from the 60s and 70s, depending on the region, was pretty much used by the early movement in Belgrado. That is to say that meetings in which gay and lesbians talked about their personal experiences was a major strategy to build a common agenda. What is the role played by feminism in the LGBT movement today in the region? How are the meetings organized nowadays? That's my first question. The second question is about Svetlana's presentation, in which I could realize that the registration of the groups play a fundamental role in the movement, because you're talking about two other organizations being registered. Which role is played by this registration, and what does that mean? How do you get an organization registered? And the final one is about security. A fellow activist from Brazil told me that our army is so small that each activist is like a pearl. How do you address security issues in your organizations, not only among the leadership, but with all of those youngsters that Boris were talking about and Svetlana also? Thank you very much.
Do you want me to repeat questions, or did you get that?
Different things,
it's not that difficult to have the organization registered. However, people in Bosnia, especially young people, are so full of ideas and enthusiasm, and sometimes there's more ideas and enthusiasm than actual work that's being put in. Activism, although it's based on an idea, requires huge amounts of work, and all of you know that. And one of those sections is carrying a project, being there, following on. You have to know all these skills you have to put into yourself, you have to put time and overtime. You know, I basically used to work 7 days a week. And although I believe in specific things and I'm a leader on the street, I have to do a lot of silent steps to get the work done. I have to engage a lot of communication. And if people are not able to register and have a better status for them as a credible organization, then maybe they're also not able to carry on the project. It doesn't really play any specific role, except that credibility and the fact that you have to kind of do the work. It only took us 5 months to get registered, however, so maybe that also speaks a little bit about that. Security issues. Security issues is something that we never paid too much attention to until the Greece Battle Festival. I had been asked 5 years ago how I dare walk on the street without a bodyguard. I was attacked that same very night. I didn't really understand why I would be able to walk on the street. It was not a public attack. But I think it was only during the recital festival that we felt that the security issues are extremely important. Since then, we have put an alarm system, we have put a video surveillance, we have attempted to buy pepper sprays for all our members, which we couldn't go through because we haven't had an ID card to do that. We have been advised through all different things in order to be able to secure our premises, and members and people who come and work there so that we would be able to better do our work. We have also made a radical decision that during the festival of this year, not to be in town at all, so actually three of us who were the primary organizers left. Security is not only an issue of physical security, and what's more important to me is the psychological security and safety that you feel, because once you start meeting your demons, and not being able to take care of that, it's not a pretty situation. So we basically learned it the hard way. And I would really advise everybody to do it in a different way. As long as an individual is strong and as long as an individual feels safe, regardless of his physical, spiritual, or any other way, you kind of exude specific aura, you exude specific energy. Feel better. And if you can handle pretty much anything that goes on. But that's no longer the case with us. So we have taken specific measures to improve that. We have had members tell us that they've been extremely terrified, people who have been arrested because of that fear, or people who basically left the country. We have a lot of people who left the country since Greek Federal Festival, which is extremely unfortunate. It's not only because of Greek Federal Festival, it's about general situation, but people are actually leaving because their batteries have been empty. And security is a huge, huge issue, which we are paying more attention to, but it's not enough. I don't think you can do enough, and I don't think you should do that. We have people who are judges, who by doing their work have to have 24-hour police surveillance. We have a Bakir, who is a news journalist because of the truth that he speaks on TV. He has to have security because he and his family are threatened to be on today. I think it's very unfortunate that by using your job, you have to have full security because somebody is threatening to kill you and they're honest threats, you know, and you are doing honest work. I just don't think it's really how it should be. And there's really no security that you can feel or you can. But you should not live in a country where you, by doing your work, you can't walk freely on the street.
Okay, thank you.
There's something really wrong about that.
Yes. Morris?
Can you repeat the question about our game program?
Yeah, the question was, one of the things that people read were about
who are from Arcadia Bulletin from 94, and they're talking about both the violence and just the organizing situation. And early on in Serbia, feminist and peace movement were all intertwined. And I mean, I do think that to a certain extent still are. But the question was, how are they connected? So what he's saying is, feminist and peace movement were the main support in the creation of LGBT movement in Serbia. And first LGBT activists were more peace activists. He wants to bring Dejan Nebugic before everybody else who was killed 10 years ago. And if we think of 90s in the region, we're looking at, this is the peak of the war in the Balkans, so he was killed, Dejan was killed by the father of his ex-partner on December 29th, 1999. So partnering of feminist and LGBTIQ movement was sort of a fairly natural connection, and it still exists to a certain extent in Serbia. The problem that we have now is that the feminist movement is older, it has a longer tradition. And it is to a certain extent not staying in line with the changes in the society at all. And so every once in a while there are certain fractions, there are certain conflicts because of this. There's a need to resolve this problem. And it's very likely that this is something that is likely to get resolved in the next few years. Because LGBTIQ question is a gender issue. And so it is a natural connection between the feminists and the LGBT. The question about the registration of the organizations. It's very easy to register an organization in Serbia. You have to go through certain bureaucratic workings. You fill out the paperwork, the right paperwork. But we have a problem because the international community is supporting the NGO movements less and less because Serbia is not interesting anymore. They're moving
So the Balkans is losing a lot of support that used to come from. On the other hand, the state, the country itself, did not find a way to support civil movements. So there's very little support. So the support from outside is draining out, it's not coming in anymore, and the support from the country itself is not happening. So a lot of these organizations are not getting any kind of support. And this, the country doesn't really have a particular desire to help, to assist these organizations. And so we also have the internal trouble within the society. Serbia as a society, as well as former Yugoslavia. Doesn't have a tradition of NGOs, of the organizations, also to take matters in our own hands and resolve the problems. To fight for freedom and some sorts of higher goals or humanitarian goals. Did you want to address the question about safety and securing security and safety of the actors? I know you mentioned it a little bit earlier. That exists in certain countries, but so it's easy to register an organization, but that's not really, it doesn't really mean anything because there's no tradition of philanthropy within a country. Okay, so I wanted to open up people who are online. Do you have a question you wanted to submit? You should be able to type it into the chat. Also, do we have another question from the house? We're close to closing. We have a couple more minutes to wrap this up. So, before, yes?
I have a question unless there are questions from the chat.
No, you're fine. Okay. Yeah. So we have another question coming in.
Hello, thank you so much for your remarks. Looks like there's a question out there, I'll let you address that.
Okay, so the question is, what is the meaningful support you all could get from international LGBTIQ groups? Either one of you can grab it. Svetlana?
So how are you going to do it?
thinker on the other side, or reading personally is something that
I think we froze on Svetlana, just so you know. Boris, did you want to add something? So Boris is saying it could be great to try to import some of the cultural products. And to build on that. There are very few events that are happening in the actual space. There are very few events that are public events that are happening. And so that are open for people to gather around. And so what he's suggesting, it would be great if actually they could work with IRN and flags and to think of possibly having events that are sort of crossing borders.
But doesn't he have parties?
He's remembering there was an event in 2008, New Year's, where I was invited to perform, and I performed at the New Year's party at the gay club. And he's saying that that was one of his fond memories, because that was amazing. What's he saying? He's saying that.
Awesome. Yes, I mean, I understand that they have a meeting here at 8, so I wonder if we should start wrapping up.
And also because, you know, there was very little competition in terms of having queer events for New Year's Eve. That was one of the only events. And so it would be nice to inspire people by having more events in a region. Not just the boring human rights activists and politicians, but to actually have more cultural happenings. I want to thank you both. We're actually getting people coming into the space who have something happening at 8 o'clock, so we have to end this now. I want to thank you both, and as well as people who are online watching us and people here. And I hope we can have more things like this in the future.